So good evening everyone. Today we will start with this magnetic resonance imaging. Initially when this magnetic resonance imaging introduced into the medical practice, it was called nuclear medicine imaging. However, with the term this nuclear medicine over here, people were afraid of this term nuclear medicine, and they were very apprehensive of using this technique, because nuclear thing, it is associated with something which is quite ionizing and destructive in nature. So people were not ready to accept this jargon, and hence later on this imaging techniques was renamed as magnetic resonance imaging. Most of you must have heard of NMR. So NMR spectroscopy, this NMR spectroscopy, it is basically the principle of this NMR spectroscopy and the principle of the magnetic resonance imaging, both of are essentially same. With some slight tweak, where we get only a single dimensional information in the NMR spectroscopy with respect to the frequency, but over here we get a special domain information in the magnetic resonance imaging. Now, all of us know that whenever we are talking about an atom, it is having a nuclei, and in this nuclei we are having nucleons. What are these nucleons? These nucleons are basically the neutrons and the protons. There are several atoms which have an odd number of protons. Now this odd number of protons, they result in the due to this single odd number of protons, the atoms which have this odd number of protons, they behave as tiny magnets. One of the classical example of the protons which have of the atom which have an odd number of protons is the hydrogen atom, which has only one proton. And we all know that major constituent, this hydrogen atom, it forms the major constituent of our body. So we can see in our body there are several tiny magnets, Now why we do not have a magnetic field across us, So what happens is that this protons or the tiny magnets which are present, their dipole moments, they are arranged in a random fashion. So due to this reason, what happens is that the net magnetic moment comes out to be zero. So we do not exhibit any magnetic properties. But what happens is that if we place a very strong magnetic field across our body, which is having a magnetic field of B0, and this B0, it is usually 1 Tesla or more. These are usually 1 Tesla or more. Okay. So what happens is that majority of the atoms a large number of atoms, they get aligned to this magnetic field and they are called the parallel alignment. So it is called that they are in parallel alignment. However, there are other group of atoms which aligns themselves in the anti-parallel manner. Okay, which aligns themselves in the anti-parallel manner. So if you look over here, what I have seen, what I have drawn is that there are some atoms which are parallelly aligned and there are some atoms which are anti-parallelly aligned. Okay. Now the atoms which are parallelly aligned, they are having low energy state. Okay, whereas the anti-parallel atoms, they have high energy state. Okay, think of a condition, there is a river and the flow of the river is from left to right. Right? Now, if you want to swim along the flow of the river, you will need lesser energy. Okay? On the contrary, if you want to swim against the flow of the river, you will be needing a higher amount of energy. Okay? The same thing happens over here also, where B0, it can be it can be compared with the flow of the river. So it is having a permanent direction, it is a permanent magnetic field. So it is having a direction. So any atoms which are aligned to this B0 field, they are said to be in low energy state, and the atoms which are anti-parallelly aligned, they are said to be in a high energy state. Okay. Now if you see, I have just drawn 4 representative atoms in the parallel state and 3 atoms in the anti-parallel state. What does this signify? It signifies that even though we are putting a very high magnetic field, the number of atoms which are in the parallel alignment is slightly higher than the number of the atoms which are in the alignment of anti-parallel state. Okay. So typically, it has been found that if we apply a 1.5 Tesla magnetic field, and if we are considering approximately 2 million atoms, then only 9 number of atoms will be in excess towards the B0 field. Okay. What does that mean? That means if you look over here, if you consider this atom, the magnetic moment of this atom will be cancelled by this atom, this atom by this atom, this atom by this atom. So here we are having only one excess atom which is contributing towards the magnetic field, local magnetic field. In this case, if we use 1.5 Tesla and we are having, suppose we are having 2 million atoms over that particular field, then only 9 number of atoms will be in this parallel alignment state. Okay, only 9 number of atoms will be in the parallel alignment state. Okay, so you can see it is very feeble, right? Now I have told that they are present, they are randomly present. When I apply this thing, they become aligned or they get anti-alignment, whatever. But this is not it. Just like our earth or a spinning top, these atoms, they also recess. Okay, so suppose this is the alignment, this is the top. Now top, it rotates across its this axis, the nail which you put in, it rotates over there. And also when its energy is being towards the end of the depletion, when it is losing its kinetic energy, it also rotates across its central axis, right? Yes or no? The same thing happens over here also. These atoms under this B0 field, they precess at an angle of theta. Okay? And at which frequency it will precess, that is called Larmor frequency. That is called Larmor frequency. Okay? So this frequency, it is a very important frequency, and you should keep this in mind. Okay? And you should keep this in mind. What is Larmor frequency? Larmor frequency is the frequency at which the atoms are precessing when you are applying applying an external magnetic field. Okay? Yeah, it will rotate on its axis and again also against the central axis.
So then that will be in two different frequencies.
Yeah, we are basically considering this one, the central one. This at what angle it is rotating. So this is the top. So this top, how it is rotating across this. So this is this we call it as the this is the direction of B0 basically. Across this B0, how it is across the axis of the B0, parallel axis of B0, how they are precessing, we just consider that as the precessing angle or precession frequency. The Larmor frequency, it is also regarded as the precession frequency. Okay. Now this Larmor frequency, it is given by omega. Okay. Omega equals to gamma b. Omega is equal to gamma b. Okay, what is gamma? Gamma is gyromagnetic ratio. Okay, gamma is gyromagnetic ratio, and its unit is megahertz per tesla. Megahertz per tesla. The unit of this tesla, it gets multiplied with this b, and we are left with the frequency component. Okay, now what happens over here? If the gyromagnetic ratio, it remains same, what we can change? We can change only the magnetic field. Okay, we can change only the magnetic field. Okay, so we can see that frequency is dependent on the directly dependent on the magnetic field, right?
So
So next what? You are having this, it is rotating, it is very good. So another important thing over here is that if you apply a magnetic field, external magnetic field in the radio frequency range, in the RF range, okay, so if you give a pulse, what you are doing? You are disturbing this rotating atom, okay. So what should be the frequency of this RF? The RF will only be able to disturb this atom only and only when the frequency of the RF and the Larmor frequency, that means the frequency of the atom with which it is precessing, they match. Okay, so that is called resonant frequency. That's why the name comes magnetic resonance in the MRI. Okay, right? Pardon? It depends. It depends in which way, because perpendicular is a what do you call? You consider a 3D object. Okay, if you are considering a 3D object over here, so you are having this top rotating over here. So you can give at any angle basically. Okay, so you can give it at any angle, but there is a trick also. When we do the imaging of the human body, it depends, not always 180 degree. Okay, so you are basically giving some pulse, so energy you can give from any direction, that should not be a problem. Okay, it has to be radio frequency, because the frequency at which these atoms precess, they are in the radio frequency range.
The Larmor frequency is already
in radio frequency. Yeah, it is already in the precession frequency, it's already in the this thing. So Larmor frequency is in the radio frequency range, and you are just giving an external energy. Now the energy can be from anywhere else. Okay. So when you give the energy to this atom, the atom can go or align itself in two different ways. The first one, when we are considering this XY plane, suppose this is X, this is Y, and this is Z, and Z plane, across this Z plane we also have this B naught, and then when we give the RF pulse, this atom which is here, it can either come in this XY plane. Okay, it can come in this XY plane. So what is this XY plane? This is it. As compared to the Z, this XY plane is the transverse plane. And it is coming at an angle of 90 degree. So we can say if the RF pulse, the strength of the RF pulse is sufficient to flip this atom at 90 degree, then it is called 90 degree flip. Okay. On the contrary, if we can give sufficient energy so that this atom flips at an angle of 180 degrees, that means it becomes anti-parallel to the B0 axis. It becomes anti-parallel to the B0 axis. Okay. Then it is called 180-degree flip. Okay. Now, when I am talking about this RF pulse, pulse means you are momentarily giving this energy. Okay. You are momentarily giving this energy. Okay. We usually initially give 90-degree flip energy, okay, so that the energy the atom comes in the transverse plane. The energy comes in the transverse plane. I'm just redrawing it. Initially, we had this atom in this position in the blue form, ZB0, and then after the 90-degree flip, it has come into the transverse plane, right? I told it is precessing. So when it has come to the transverse plane, what is happening? It will still precess. But its base will be attached to the origin of the 3D plane. Say for example, okay. Now how it is precessing? It is precessing in a circular fashion, in this fashion. Previously it was doing across this Z axis. Now in the transverse plane it is moving. So if I am having this palm, suppose this is the this transverse plane, then it is rotating in this fashion, right? So if you look from top, this is the origin. So this atom is moving in this fashion. This is the top view. Okay. But at the same time, it is not aligned with the B0. Right? If it is not aligned with the B0, that means the atom is at a high energy state. And our nature's principle is that we do not want anything in a high energy state. We want to be in the low energy state. Okay? So what will happen? It will try to return back. Suppose this atom is over here, x. So it will try to return back in this fashion. But will it do so? No, it is not capable of doing so. Why? So it is not that easy. Why it is not that easy? Because it is also precessing. So what will happen? It will move, it will go. Then it will again open up, it will gain some this thing, so it will try to come to this original state in this fashion. So every time you see, there is an increment in some this thing. So it is, it will look like, if you look over here, you consider this base, initially it is same from the center. It is here, at the next moment you will find it is here, and at the same time it is rotating in this fashion, right? not cone shaped, this is basically this spiral. Okay, so it is in a spiral way, it is coming to the position which is at a low energy state. Okay, so what it is doing? So now we are having two planes to consider with, or two points to be considered with. We have a set of energy in the xy plane, and then we have a set of energy which we can look in the b0 or the z plane direction, z axis direction, not plane, it is the axis, z axis direction and the xy plane. So how the energies are varying in the xy plane and how the energy is varying in the z axis direction, that we have to understand. Okay, now before going into that, let's see that the gyromagnetic ratio for the hydrogen one atom, it is 42.58. so you should remember this. The gyromagnetic ratio of the other atoms are also given, but that is not of use for us in the medicine, in the MRI imaging, but you have to keep this number in mind. So it can be asked, what is the gyromagnetic ratio of hydrogen one atom. Okay, so can you tell me, if I have to look into the energy component in the xy plane, what would happen? Energy released. Released means decreasing, right? So if I plot an xy curve where my x axis is say time and y is magnetization of xy in the xy plane, or the magnetic field in the xy plane, so he said released, so there will be decrease. So how it will decrease?
Because it is coming from unstable.
High energy state.
Low.
So in xy plane initially we are having high energy state, then it will go to zero. Okay, and if we look through the z axis, again time versus m of z, initially it will be zero and then it will gain 100% energy. Here it will be 100% and here at longer time duration, we will be having 100% magnetic magnetization vector, or strength of the magnetic field will increase. Okay, in the xy it is decreasing, in mz it is increasing. So this plot, it is called T1 plot. So here also, so this process is relaxation, high energy to the low energy, it is relaxation. So this plot, it is called this T1 plot, or the spin relaxation process, and this is spin lattice relaxation process. Sorry, the T1 is the spin lattice. Sorry, the T1 is the spin lattice relaxation, and T2 is the spin relaxation. Okay. So how does it move? If you look, mz, it is equal to m0 into 1 minus e to the power minus t by capital T1, where t is the time, m0 is the initial magnetic field, and that magnetic field is basically this b0, the permanent magnetic field, m0. Okay, Now over here you get this thing. Okay. So which time instance? Because when we are talking about the relaxation time, so we have to calculate the time. So which one is T1 relaxation? This is at 63% of the original string, wherever you will be getting that time component, it will be your T1 relaxation for that material. Okay. Depending upon the materials, you may have short T1 or you may have long T1. Okay. Whereas M of XY, it is given by M0 into e to the power minus t by t2. Okay. And over here we look into 37% of the maximum value, whatever you are getting. So that is regarded as the t2. So again over here we are having short t2, we are having long t2. Okay. Now T1 for fat it is 100 millisecond and for water it is 200 millisecond. Okay. T1 for fat is 100 millisecond and for water it is 2000 millisecond. Okay. That means the hydrogen atoms which are present in the fat, they relax quickly as compared to the hydrogen atoms which are present in the water molecules. Okay. Now we have seen the process that we are having T1 and T2 which is happening simultaneously, right? Because it is, these are the same thing which we are measuring, we are measuring both T1 and T2 from the same event. Okay. We are measuring this T1 and T2 for the same event because our atom is same, which is moving inside the within the transverse plane, and how it is going back to the original space, that we are calculating. From there we are trying to calculate the T1 and T2. So the event is same, but we are looking the same event from two different perspectives. One is from the transverse plane and the other is from the longitudinal plane. Okay. Even though we are having the same event and we are looking into the same perspective, from the same perspective, it is important to know that the T2 decay more rapidly. The T2 decay, the relaxation time T2, which is basically the spin-spin relaxation, it happens quite quickly. Okay. Now from here, we have a phenomenon which is called free induction decay. Okay. Free induction decay. So what is free induction decay? Free induction decay is decay of transverse magnetization. Decay of transverse magnetization. Okay. So what is that? Transverse means XY plane. So decay of magnetization in the transverse plane, how it is happening? That if you record that, that is called free induction decay. Now how that is happening? We said that it is moving from here to here, going to the here. So energy in the transverse plane is decreasing. But we also said it is precessing. Precession means sinusoidal. Okay? You are getting, if your detector is at a fixed point, when the atom is towards that detector, it will be having the higher energy. Again, when it will be farthest from the detector, it will be having lower energy. So what is happening? It is not a straight decay like this. What you are having? You are starting with a straight point, straight line like this you are getting. Now this is what you are getting over here. See, it is starting at a maximum point and then it is going to the negative, coming back to the positive and going again like this. And if you look into this curve, this exponential curve, this will give you the information. Okay, so this is free induction decay. Now this free induction decay, how we are measuring? We are measuring the signal emitted by this atom or the group of atoms which are precessing at a particular frequency, and when they are going back to the original frequency, we are just measuring the energy which is being released. While they are going back from here to this towards this B0 axis, it is losing energy. But energy cannot be destroyed. If it is losing energy, the rest of the energy it has to emit. Now that emission, again it is in the radio frequency range. Right? Now those radio frequency has been picked up. Right? Now those radio frequency, they are being picked up. Okay? Now what is happening over here now? In FID, we are basically getting this signal with respect to time. This is signal intensity. Like this we are getting. Okay? So this is free induction decay. Now suppose you are having a human body and you are having this thing, and if you place this one, you have applied a B0 field over here. Okay, now if you place an RF signal, you give this, the atoms in this region, they will precess at a particular frequency. The atoms in the other regions, they will be precessing at a certain other frequency. Okay, so if you give it this radio frequency which matches with the precession frequency of these objects, let me draw this in maybe red color, of these red objects, what will happen? The radio frequency which will be emitted by these atoms will be again be picked up this RF coil. And all of these three materials, three objects within this human body, they are precessing at the same frequency, and because of that you will be getting a decay. For all of this you will be getting a decay. Okay, but still it is not giving you any information over here. Okay,
How you will get the information? You will get the information when you do Fourier transform. You will get the information when you do Fourier transform. Still no. I will come to that, how to get back to that. So what a Fourier transform does? You are getting a frequency component. This is a sinusoidal frequency, and you know the it is precessing at a particular angle and at a particular frequency. So the precession frequency, it remains the same. So you will get only a particular frequency at this stage, right? So what Fourier transform will do? Again, intensity and frequency. At a particular frequency, you will be getting a peak. Okay. Say F sample. Now the peak of this this curve, the height of this curve, it will be dependent on the number of these objects which are present, quantum of atoms which are present. So if you would have only one, then the height of the peak would have been 1/3 of that, of this original peak. Okay. So apart from all this thing, what we have done, we have been able to identify that whether a particular object is present or not within the body. Okay, this is what till now we have achieved over here up to this point. Okay, now as I said, the T2 decay more rapidly. Now this T2, it has a very unique thing. So we cannot directly measure T2. Okay, why? Because T2 is not present alone. It is present in a local environment. Okay, the atoms, they are present at a local environment. And when they are at a higher energy state, that local environment, it plays a very important role. Okay, so that local environment, whatever the things are there, it has also some effect, and that effect is being accounted into this T2 dash, which is due to the local variations. And this T2 dash is 10 to 100 times shorter than T2. Okay, so over here, what is happening now? Now the modulation of the frequencies are happening. Modulation of the signals are happening, basically. Okay, T2, it is trying to pull down the original free induction decay very rapidly. Okay, so what we actually measure using this RF coil is T2 star. Now the relation between T2 star, T2 and T2 dash is 1 by T2 star is equal to 1 by T2 plus 1 by T2 dash. And this T2 star, it is called local variations in the magnetic field and non-uniformities within the tissues. Okay. Now here I have told an important thing, local variations in the magnetic field. Non-uniformities within the tissue, we all know. Now, what is this local variations in the magnetic field? When we are applying some magnetic field, what we do is that we have to select a slice. Now, any slice, it will be having some thickness. Now, for the selection of the slice, what we have to do is that we have to apply a gradient field. So typically a gradient field, it may vary from 0.01 tesla to 0.01 tesla, minus of 0.01 tesla to plus of this thing. So there is a variation. So when we are selecting a slide, within this variation we are selecting a particular range. Now this particular range itself will be having some variations. How do you take that into account? You cannot take that into account, and that also lead that will lead to the what you call inhomogeneity, and that will lead to this T2 star, which is due to the local variations in the magnetic field. And tissue, all we know that all the tissues, they may not be homogeneous, because biological samples, they are not homogeneous, they are non-homogeneous in nature, right? So what to do? How do we measure this T2? How do you measure this T2? There is an interesting phenomenon. He said that we give 180 degree pulse. Now that comes into picture over here. And what we call it? We call it spin echo technique. Okay. Now let's look into the transverse plane. This is the top view of the transverse plane. When you have given the RF pulse, all the atoms, they have become obedient and they have aligned at a single direction. Say for example, it is in the zero direction, a 0 degree angle. Okay. But again, you have taken the energy out. So you people are sitting because I am sitting in a very orderly fashion over here, because I am sitting over here. The moment I leave from here, everyone of you will be going in a different speed. There will be chaos basically, right? So what will happen? Atoms are precessing, they are moving in this direction. Some of them will start moving faster. Okay. Some may go in the opposite direction also. Slowly they will try to spread out. Slowly they will try to spread out. And what will happen? So you see, so this this will come, this one will come over here, this is in this position, it is moving like this, and this will come over here, this is moving like this. Okay, they are trying to merge over here. Now at this location, if you apply an RF, what will happen? They will come on the opposite side again, 180 degree flip. Okay. So what will happen? This is coming over here. It has flipped, but it is moving like this. It has flipped, but it will move like this. They will again try to come in phase, back in phase. Okay. So when they will be trying to getting into back in phase, you will be getting this curve. Again, the same process will start. It will start losing its energy. Right? Again, you do this. Again, it will come in phase. Again, it will go down. Now, if you see, the first peak, it was having a highest energy. The second peak, it is having a somewhat lower energy. Third peak, it is having a somewhat lower energy. Then, if you try to join these peaks, that will give you
the actual T2 relaxation. Okay, that will give you the actual T2 relaxation. The process by which we get this actual T2 relaxation, it is called spin echo relaxation. What happens? What is echo? Somewhere if you speak, it will go. Then after some time, you will hear again. Then after some time, again you will hear something. And what will happen? There will be a reduction in the intensity of the voices as the time progresses, and ultimately it will die down. Right? The same thing is also happening over here. Now, how we are able to induce this spin echo? We are able to induce this spin echo by applying this 180 degree pulse at regular intervals. Okay. So this spin echo, it will help us in getting the actual T2 information. Okay. So based upon this T1 and T2, we can get two type of images: T1 weighted image and T2 weighted image. Okay. So next thing will already time is over, so we'll be discussing about the next stage in the next class. Yeah.
So essentially you are telling that alternating the RF coil, it will be given in 180 degree opposite direction.
Not a 180 degree opposite direction. RF coils, they are present at a particular location. They are present at a location. If I have to if I have to hit you, I can stay over here and I can just throw something to hit you. Okay. So if I have to hit him, I don't have to change my space. I can stay here only. I can just hit him from here. Okay. So RF is wireless, right? RF is wireless, so there is no medium you will need. So you can have the detector. It's all about transferring the energy from the RF coil to the atom, and RF is a wireless thing. So you are just transferring the energy. You just control the strength of the RF which is being generated. Higher the magnitude of the RF coil, the higher will be the energy which will be transferred to the atoms. Okay. So if you see over here, the 90 degree pulse, it looks something like this. 180 degree, almost double the height. So it is basically the energy content. How the energy, you can increase the energy? By increasing the intensity or the amplitude of the signal, RF signal. The only thing is frequency.
So while disturbing 90 degree angle, the required frequency, and while it disturbing 180 degree angle, those will be different.
Why that will be different? No.
Because higher energy.
Frequency is same. Frequency is dependent on the magnetic field. That's what I told you. Frequency is dependent on the magnetic field. It is not dependent on the RF signal what you are giving. When you are giving a permanent magnetic field, that means what you are doing? You have fixed the frequency. You have locked the frequency. Okay. So all the atoms, they are processing at a single frequency. Now you are giving the energy.
The energy frequency of that energy should match this amount.
Which one?
The pulse frequency.
Energy is a separate thing. I am talking about frequency. Frequency and energy are both a different thing. Energy is about, it is in the 3D plane. Right? So,
it's all about positional energy. Okay, suppose you are here. Okay, if you go to the fourth floor, will you change your characteristics? You are not changing your characteristics, but you have gained potential energy. Okay, the same thing happens over here. When you're giving this RF pulse, you're changing the potential energy within these atoms. So they are now at a lower level, this XY plane. Okay, and when they are getting towards the Y axis, towards the B0, they're losing the energy, but the frequency remains same. Frequency is dependent on the magnetic field. Okay. Any other question?
You told that even though in fact you apply the field, there's like parallel and anti-parallel, and the number ratio between them is almost similar. It's like very small.
Very small, yeah.
Yeah. So logically thinking, the number of atoms which are parallel, which are like lower energy, should be higher, like higher by a larger margin. So this small margin.
Which one? I didn't get you. The next part. That's what happening.
Number, rather than like 9 to 1 million, which seems to be a very small difference.
Yeah, so this is nature.
Yeah, so is that due to the higher decay of T2? Or like
higher decay of T2? No, T2 and T1, it comes only when we are giving the pulses.
Okay, so without the pulses, then why is there such a distribution, sir?
That I also don't know, frankly speaking. So why that distribution? So it's all about maybe the property of the material, of the tissues. Because this happens everywhere. Whatever sample you take for the analysis, if you take any sample for the NMR analysis, over there also you have the same thing. That's why people are trying to increase this B. When you increase this B, what happens is that you are trying to increase the number of the atoms which are parallel to the B0. So initial stage, this MRI machines, they started with 0.5. Then commercially, when it came, which was used for the human clinical purpose, it was 1 Tesla. Till now, it has gone to 3 Tesla. Up to 3 Tesla machines are there. And some people are working for research purpose up to 5 Tesla. They are all trying to increase the number of these atoms which are parallel to the B0 axis. Why? Because as you increase the B0, the number of atoms from where you will be getting the signal, actual signal, it will be more. So the quality of the signal will be much better. So people are striving for more and for aligning more and more this atoms which are in excess to increase that number. Okay, so that they can get a better quality signal. Right. So, yeah. Anything else? No?